Good afternoon. Oh dear, my notes seem to have moved the PC, so I hope we can recover from that. My name is Ed Scott. I'm the chairman of the Center for Global Development. I want to welcome all of you here today. It is obvious to you that I'm losing my voice, which some people think is a good thing. But it's a great pleasure to participate in this event once a year. We have here a who's who of people who know about and care about development issues, and I thank them for coming. And I think you're all going to enjoy today's presentation, which is different in many respects from some of the ones we've had in the past from economists and others who are more centrally part of the development scene. CGD, in its 12 years now, has cast its net pretty wide in terms of the subjects it looks into and where and the policies it develops and analyzes, with the hope and expectation that the rich countries will be a little bit more intelligent and prudent with respect to how they relate to the less rich countries. I think we've done a good job at that. I'm not going to spend a lot of time reciting our many accomplishments. I think most of you know them, and I'm very happy that Nancy Birdsall and her colleagues have been able to create such a distinguished place of learning and development policy. Today's presentation will focus to a large degree on the use of technology for personal identification. It's a subject that the Center for Global Development is looking at, and the subject, curiously enough, which I had some personal involvement in over 30 years ago at the when I was the head of planning for the U.S. Immigration Service, and I led the team that designed the new green card, which some of you, in fact, in this room may have in your pocket. But as I was telling Nandan earlier, we didn't have the benefits of modern technology when we developed that card, so we had to do some other different things. But the challenges were basically the same in terms of how people feel about a unique ID and how people in many parts of the developing world are actually well ahead of the U.S. in their thinking about this subject. This is the 8th annual Sabot lecture. I mentioned to Nancy earlier that it seems like yesterday when she and Dick Sabot and I sat outside in a nice summer day up on Connecticut Avenue and talked about what the Center for Global Development might look like if we were able to bring it into fruition. And in the early days, first two or three years of the existence of the center, Dick was a valued and extremely effective member of our board, giving the board and Nancy sound and wise advice about what the center should be doing. We're joined today, as we have been in most years past, by Dick's family, his wife Judith, and his son Oliver, and his sister Ann are here, and we thank them for coming. And I can't tell you how much pleasure it gives me to be able to honor Dick and with this annual event, because he truly was a visionary And as whoever wrote these notes for me observed, being a technologist and an entrepreneur, he would be very interested in what you're going to hear this afternoon. So Oliver will make a few remarks about his dad and about various experience he has had. He has been working up until very recently with the Clinton Foundation on areas of interest, which would have made his father extremely proud of him. So with that somewhat disjointed introduction, I give you Oliver Sabot.
Well, thanks, Ed, and it's a great pleasure to be here again. And I think Ed said it exactly right, that we've had a range of distinguished and brilliant speakers through this lecture series over the past 7 years. But I firmly believe that my father would be most excited by this talk tonight. And that's for two reasons. The first, I remember one evening at the dinner table, my father was sitting there quite upset because of a conversation that he had had with a man who was doing work on our house at that time, who had expressed some radical views. I said to him, just ignore him, don't take him seriously. And my father looked at me very intently and said, I take everyone seriously. And as I thought about the talk this evening, I realized that fundamentally at the heart of Mr. Nilekani's work is taking everyone seriously. And the spirit of what my father believed, that what matters is not someone's class or creed or race or birthplace, but the level of opportunity that they've had in their lives and what they do with that opportunity. And this intervention has the potential to get policy so much closer to judging people and treating people in that way. And the second reason simply is that Mr. Nilekani's not just talking about it, he's doing it. And while my father believed in research and thought and reflection, he was fundamentally impatient for action, which led him to become an entrepreneur. So I want to thank the center for pulling together another great lecture. I want to thank Mr. Nilekani for coming all this way, and I'm equally excited to hear the talk this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Oliver, and thanks to all of you who've joined us today. For any of you who don't know, I'm Nancy Birdsall, the proud president today of the Center for Global Development. Certainly, Dick would be very proud of Oliver, too. I have the great pleasure of introducing to you this year's Sabot lecturer, Nandan Nilekani, who epitomizes, as you've already heard, several combinations of things, but I think most interesting, the intersection of private entrepreneurship and public service at its very best, both as a private entrepreneur and in what he is doing in his role as a public servant. He is a co-founder of Infosys, an Indian, as you know, multinational provider of business consulting, technology, engineering, and outsourcing services. He served as CEO there from 2002 to 2007. Infosys has been voted India's most admired company in surveys conducted by the Wall Street Journal Asia every year since 2000. That is impressive. It has also been ranked as one of the world's most innovative companies by Forbes and one of the world's top 10 green companies by Newsweek. I also know from other information that Infosys has been sort of top-notch in its approach to corporate governance. Since 2009, Nandan has been the chair of the Unique Identification Authority of India, which is it's a ministerial post. And the Unique Identification Authority is a global model for providing identification as a means to empower ordinary citizens. including especially, and this is one of the reasons why we've been paying a lot of attention at the center, poor people who are recipients often through inefficient and sometimes corrupt intermediaries of many benefits from the government of India. The idea of this is to help cut through that intermediation and move resources directly to people who are targeted because they need those resources. He's also an author of a wonderful book, I am told, by Arvind Subramanian, my colleague, who is the head of our Indian initiative. He's the author of Understanding India, The Idea of a Renewed Nation. And most important, most impressive, he was on the Jon Stewart show talking about that book, where in a conversation in which Jon Stewart referred to the talk in the air that India and China were becoming the, you know, key nations, the overlords of the U.S., John said to Nandan, I welcome you as an overlord. You're such a good and gentle guy. I also want to, in introducing Nandan, extend a special welcome to his wife, Rohini Nilekani, who founded and chairs a water NGO called Argyan. She's a major player in India on water and sanitation issues. She's also a founder of Pratham Books, which seeks to put a book in every child's hand. Pratham is a very important NGO that we have been, whose work has gone really global. On testing children, it's become a model. So, you know, we have a couple here who are engaged in absolutely critical ways using different channels in support of development. Rohini, if we had a few more people in the world like you and Nandan, CGD could close up shop. But we are not closing up shop, not at all. Now, please join me in welcoming Nandan Nilekani. I'll repeat the title, Can Technology Leapfrog Development, the Aadhaar Experience? Nandan.
Thank you, Nancy. It's really great to be here at CGD giving the 8th Dick Sabot lecture. And I think, as Oliver said, I think he was a kindred soul. So I'm really delighted that I'm speaking for a lecture on his memory. I'll speak about the Aadhaar project. The Aadhaar project is something which I took up about 4 years back. And the goal of this project was to give a unique number to every resident of India. And you may wonder, you know, why would anybody do this? And the reasons actually are that manifold, but I'll give the broad two reasons. The first is that in Western countries, you know, identity happens because when a child is born, the child gets registered at birth and you have a birth certificate, and that's called as the basic or the breeder document. And once you have a birth certificate, that birth certificate establishes citizenship. It becomes the basis for subsequent documents like the passport and so on and so forth. So generally in Western countries, you know, most of the babies born are registered. Now in many developing countries, including in India, a large number of children are not registered at birth. In many states in India, about 50% of the births are not registered. And therefore, you actually have the situation where you have a number of, you know, large number of, I'm talking about millions and millions of people out there who don't have any acknowledgement of their existence by the state. They don't have a birth certificate, and therefore they don't have any of the consequential documents that you need. And historically, this was not such a big deal, because if you lived and died in the same village, you know, it was like cheers, everybody knew your name, and therefore you didn't really have to have a document. But as you had a much more aspirational group of people who migrated from villages, went to cities, went from North India to South India, it became increasingly apparent that not having any form of an identity, a document, is really a serious handicap because they don't get access to anything because they can't prove who they are. And therefore, in some sense, you can think of this as a project to give everyone, every resident, that document or that entity, that identity, which then allows them to participate in the economy, in society, in getting jobs, in traveling around, and so on. So this is very, very important. So when you look at it from that perspective, it's really a huge project of social inclusion. It's about giving people a chance to be part of the formal society or the formal economy. That's the point from the point of view of the people. Now, why is it important from the point of view of the government? The reason is that as India and builds a welfare society, which is it's been doing that for the last decade and last 13 years, it's been rolling out all kinds of entitlement programs, entitlements that give guaranteed employment or healthcare or education or food and pensions, scholarships, and so forth. And ultimately, all these entitlements and even subsidies go to individuals. And when the individual is not clearly identified, and when you don't have an accurate record of individuals, then these entitlement subsidies can often go to the wrong people, and therefore you can have inefficiency and wastage in your entitlement programs, which today run into billions of dollars. So as the expenditure over the last decade has gone up on social programs, the need to make it much more efficient, much more effective, much more equitable has gone up. And therefore, there's a need from the government point to also be to identify individuals very well. And in some sense, in the United States, the same thing happened in the 1930s when Roosevelt passed the Social Security Act as part of the whole New Deal and all that. And fundamentally, they required a way to have identity for every American citizen because he would pay into the Social Security when he was working and he would draw from it later. And that's how the whole concept of a Social Security number began in the US. And such numbers have therefore been very much part of the welfare state in Sweden in 47, in Britain in 1953. So in the 20th century, as the welfare state got played out in Europe and America, you had the concept of a number for everyone. Now, India didn't have that number thing, but now as they were rolling out this welfare state, having some kind of an ID was very, very important. So fundamentally, the purpose of this project is twofold. On one, to give millions of people an ID which they can then have to get access to various services, and two, to improve the quality of expenditure of government on various public programs. Now, this is the goal. The question that arises then is, how do you do this? How do you give a billion people an ID? One could say that you can just have them come in and you can give them an ID and they can go out. But then how do you make sure that a person has only one ID? Because if you have, let's say you have 100 million people who don't have an ID and they all come in for an ID, you have no idea whether the person is going to get only one ID, or they're going to come on 10 different names, or they're going to go to 10 different locations. So really, if you don't get that fundamental ID thing right in the beginning, then you're liable to have a huge amount of consequential implications of that inaccuracy of the beginning. So getting the root ID right was very, very important. And that's how we came to the conclusion that the only way we could do that was by using biometrics. Now, biometrics has a big history in the world. Biometrics was the first use of biometrics was actually back in India in the 1870s when the British used that for land titling and all, and they used people's fingerprints to record registration of documents. And historically, the use of biometrics till maybe a few years back was essentially in forensics. It was about crime investigation and crime detection, and you had all these Perry Mason novels where you took the fingerprint off the glass and figured out who was the killer and all that. So fundamentally, biometrics was used for forensic purposes. But after 9/11, biometrics has increasingly been used for the purpose of surveillance or security or for immigration control. Today, when you and I mean, not you, but when a non-American lands up at JFK Airport, you give your fingerprints. You we all give our biometrics. So that was for the purpose of identifying potential people who are coming in, or security and so forth. So you can think of that as the second phase of biometrics. What we have done, and that's why it's important to understand the difference, is this is the use of biometric technology for development purposes. It's for using it for making access to services easier for people. And the reason why we had to use biometrics was we had to have a reasonably foolproof way of making sure that when we were giving a billion people an ID, that everybody got only one ID. How do you make sure everybody gets only one ID? It's a complex problem. And we came to the conclusion that if we take sufficient data, biometric data of an individual, then that person's biometrics will be unique across a billion people. Now, we have to find that out. We haven't done it yet. So we'll discover it as we go along. But we came to the conclusion that if you take the 10 fingerprints and the iris of both the eyes, there's enough data variation in that to enable us to give uniqueness over a billion people. And so that's one of the decisions we took. And this using two kinds of biometrics, using the fingerprints and the iris, is called multimodal. You use two different attributes, because if you use two different attributes, then the likelihood of getting uniqueness improves a lot. And our belief now is that across the entire billion people, we will have accuracy of 99.99% in terms of not having duplicates. In other words, across a billion people, we'll really have very high level of uniqueness. We will have a few duplicates, but there'll be something we can manage. So this biometrics, therefore, became essential because we had to find a way to conclusively make sure that everybody got a unique number. Now, this means, and this is where, you know, at my title was Technology Can Leapfrog Development, because whatever we're doing today could not have been done 5 years back. It's been made possible because of advances, because computing power has become more and more powerful, because software has become more powerful, because you have, you can set up databases for billion people, which has been shown to us by the internet companies that you can have a billion users. So all this is, you know, recent developments in technology, which we have leveraged for our purpose. So what we do is when somebody enrolls into our system, they provide very basic information. They provide the name, their address, the date of birth, and the sex, and they provide the biometrics. And this information is captured and sent to a sort of a massive database. And we then compare the biometrics of an individual against all the people who are in a database to make sure the person is not a duplicate. In other words, that the person hasn't got a number from some prior transaction. So you can imagine what this means at scale. Let's say we have a database of 300 million people, and that day a million people enroll into our system, then each of the million people that we have has to be compared against all 300 million that we have to see whether that person is a new person or whether that person has already enrolled in the system. So this is a very, very massive deduplication challenge. And we have to do that every day, because the next day another million people are going to land up. And therefore you need a way to really process that. And so this is really built using the same technology which is used in the internet companies. You know, internet companies have built these massive databases, the Facebooks and the YouTubes of the world, where they can, you know, have a billion users or a billion views or whatever. So using that same architecture, as it were, we have taken that and built it, used it for a developmental purpose. And so today, it's been about 2.5 years since start enrolling, we have already enrolled 380 million people into our system, 380 million people out of 1.2 billion. And we have issued numbers for about 320 million people. So that's the number of people who have been issued the number. And it is, our daily processing is about a million people a day. In other words, every day, a million people land up at our various enrollment stations, enroll into our system, and we process them and we issue them the numbers. And our goal is to reach about 400 million people this year, which we will very soon, and about 600 million people by 2014, which is about half the population of India. So at 400 million people, one out of every three Indians will be in the system. At 600 million people, one out of every two Indians will be in the system. So this requires obviously a large infrastructure. So we have about 25 to 30,000 enrollment stations where about 40 to 50 people land up per enrollment station, enroll into the system. The data is collected, then each person's data is run against the entire stack that we have, and we eliminate duplicate. So the biometrics has a very important purpose here. It is to ensure uniqueness and make sure that everybody gets a unique number. Now, the next important thing is, what is the use of this apart from giving a unique number? And this is, again, where the biometrics comes in very helpful, because we said if you're going to design an ID system in the 21st century, we must make it a digital ID system. And this is, again, an example of leapfrogging, because when ID systems were done in the US and Europe in the last century, they were not done as digital IDs, because they didn't really have all this stuff, and therefore you would get a piece of paper or you'd get a card. We said that in this new world where you can really put all the data on the cloud or all the data in a computer, then rather than giving everybody a physical ID like a piece of paper or a card, which we do give, what is really valuable is the fact that the ID is online. It is on the cloud. It's, you know, it's out there in the ether. And once the ID is on the cloud, then you can actually verify a person's ID on the network, on the internet, or on whatever technology that you have. And therefore, the big difference of this project from any other project, it's not about giving a card. It's not about giving a piece of paper. It's about giving a number which operates online, which can be used to verify your identity anywhere where you are. And this process of using the ID to verify who you are is called online authentication, because you authenticate a person. Now, authentication is something we are very familiar with, right? When you use your email, you use your username and password. And what the email service provider, can I have some water, please? What the email service provider does is, thanks, is, what the email service provider does is checks your password and says, okay, this password means I know who you are because this is the password I gave you. And that's called as a what you know kind of authentication, what you know. Similarly, when you go to an ATM and swipe your ATM card and withdraw some money, that system is saying, I know who you are because you use the ATM card issued. It's called what you have. What biometrics does is it verifies who you are. And therefore, we build a system that once you give a person a number using this thing, when they go to get a particular service, they can use either their finger or their iris to authenticate they are the person they claim to be. And therefore, the two fundamental goals of the system, one is to give everyone a unique number, and two, to use this number for verification online anywhere that they are. And here again, the other big difference of this from any other ID system is that most ID systems in the world that are done by governments tend to conflate the ID with the application. So some people do it to give a voter ID card for voting. Somebody else does it for security purposes. Somebody else does it for social security. What we have done here, which is very important, is that this is a program where the ID has been separated from the application. And the application is a layer on top of the ID. So this essentially creates an open platform for applications. So once everybody has an ID, the use of the ID for a social program is one goal. The use of the ID for citizenship is another goal. The use of the ID for health records is a third goal. So this deliberate layering in a way that the ID is separate from the application is a very, very important part of what we have done. And that's what makes it possible to develop more and more applications of the ID. And therefore, over time, what we see happening is more and more people will enroll. As I said, today we have enrolled already 380 million people, of which 320 have the IDs. And more applications will come up, applications which allow them to get some services. And as people start seeing the benefit of getting the services from the ID, more and more people will go and get this ID. And as more and more people get this ID, more and more people will build new applications which use this ID. And therefore, what we're trying to create is a virtuous cycle between people who get IDs and applications, and IDs drive applications, applications drive ID. And creating this virtuous cycle is what is going to ultimately drive us or enable us to get the entire 1.2 billion people on board this system. Now, how does this aid development? I mean, I think that's the important question. First of all, important to realize that many of the people who get this ID don't have an ID. right? So there's a migrant who's come from the village, he's come to the city, and doesn't have an ID. And therefore, when you don't have an ID, you can't apply for the public distribution system and get your entitlement of rice. You can't open a bank account. You can't get a mobile connection. You probably can't get a job because the employer wants to know who you are. So fundamentally, a lot of things get blocked out. So this ID now becomes the passport. It's like an internal passport, the passport or the gateway to various services. And what we have done is by working with the various regulators, we have worked to make this ID as sufficient for getting a particular service. For example, by working with the banking system, this ID is sufficient to open a bank account. By working with the mobile regulator, this ID is sufficient to get a mobile connection, because any service requires you to verify your identity. You know, in banking terminology, it's called know your customer. And this know your customer has become more stringent again after 9/11, because people want to make sure there's no, you know, anti-money laundering and all that. And therefore, ID has become important. But now in our system, once you have the ID, you can use this to open a bank account, get a mobile connection, get an insurance policy, get something else. So what this does is it enables you to get services. And that's why it adds. So once I get the ID, I also can go and immediately and get any of these things. And because it's an electronic system, I can do the ID verification online and do this KYC or know your customer online, which means I can give an instant product. I can give an instant bank account. I can give an instant mobile connection. I can give an instant insurance policy. And this is where the network effect comes into play. Because let's say that we have 300 million people who have this ID. And let's say that somebody launches a product for, let's say it's a new kind of an annuity product, and says, all you need is Aadhaar to get this product, then automatically all 300 million people instantly can get access to the product. So it really creates this huge network effect where you can quickly get people to ramp up and get services. And therefore, one of the fundamental values of this is as a gateway to services. And one of the reasons why the ID system, ID is very popular in India is that people see this as a gateway to getting new things or new services. Now, many people say, you know, what if the guy gives a wrong name, or what do you do and all that? But fundamentally, remember that we only give one ID. It's very important to understand that you get only one ID in the system. So the ID that you get, the name that you give, is your name in this system for the rest of your life. Now, you can think of this as the 21st century Ellis Island. What happened at Ellis Island? Ellis Island in America and Nova Scotia, you know, in Canada. So, you know, you had all these migrants who came, and, you know, one branch of the family landed in Statue of Liberty, one branch went to Nova Scotia. And there they would meet this guy, you know, this immigration guy, and he'll say, what's your name? And they would give some, you know, long-winded name from wherever they came from. And that guy said, no, from here on, this is going to be your name. So you'll have one branch of the family with a different name in Canada and in America, because at the point of entry, the name got changed. But from that day on, that was their name in the new world. So similarly, what's happening here, this is all the people are coming from the sort of non-existent world into the organized world. And therefore, whatever the name they come with into this system becomes their name for the rest of their lives. And so I think of it as a modern version of Ellis Island. So our goal is to basically give these IDs. Now, as I said, one example of these IDs is the ID itself, which is what we do. But a very, very important application of this ID is giving direct benefits or direct cash to people. And that's really an application of the ID. So the next thing we're doing with this ID platform is enabling people to get access to the benefits. Here again, when you look at Indian entitlement and subsidies, they are more than $60 billion a year. And therefore, what this program does, it enables you to directly send money to somebody's bank account by just using his ID. And that is the important thing that I can. So if suppose there's a government program which has 1,000 beneficiaries, and each of the beneficiaries has to receive, you know, 500 rupees, In the old model, it was, you know, there's a very complicated number of layers. In the new model that we have proposed, you can just say, send 500 rupees to this person's, this ID number, and the rest is all technology. So it automatically goes and gets credited into the appropriate bank account. And at the other end, using the authentication, using his biometrics, you can make sure that only that person withdraws the money from his or her bank account. And therefore, by creating this bank account infrastructure on top of the ID, you suddenly create a very sophisticated, paperless, end-to-end electronic crediting system, which allows you to credit money electronically into the account. It's okay, I don't need that. So, now this is an example of how it is used for a particular benefit. And this allows you, therefore, to credit money. It also helps in reforming subsidies. One of the ways the subsidies work in India is that the subsidy is priced into a product. So for example, if you're getting a particular thing like a can of gas, what's called LPG, liquefied petroleum gas, if it costs 900 rupees, you get it for 400 rupees. But that means that the manufacturer has to subsidize the price. So what we can do now is you can now say that let everybody sell the cylinder at 900 rupees, and the difference between the market price and subsidized price can be given as cash into your bank account, which allows you to unbundle the subsidized product from money. So these are all examples of how this particular thing can be done, and it's a very, very important thing. Now I'll quickly show you some slides on how this. This is the basic Aadhaar number. So we take the fingerprint, we take the photograph, we take the iris, and we create this database, which today has about 380 million people. We'll have about a billion people in the next few years. And we generate a unique number for everyone. The unique number is a 12-digit number, which allows you to go up to 100 billion numbers. So when somebody dies, they take the number with them. We don't reuse numbers. And then we use this for online authentication, which is the verification of the ID wherever they are. Now this also gives you portability, because if I get the ID in a village somewhere in Bihar and I come to Bombay, my ID travels with me. And therefore it's very, very important, because the ID assumes mobility of a person, because the ID travels with them online, which is on the cloud. So as I said, we have 320 million issued so far. 380 million residents have been enrolled, and our target is about 600 million by 2014. This, I told you that how we use the internet architecture. This is using what's called as big data analytics, and we are able to generate a daily status of exactly what's happening. So this is, you can go to our website, that will tell you as of this morning how many numbers were generated. So it's, you know, it's a real-time thing. It's a massive database which generates. And you can click down by state, by district, by ward, all kinds of analysis that you can do. And you can download this data and analyze it for whatever purposes. So it's all using big data. This is a little technical, but I think the important point to realize is, how did we do this? The organization that we have has less than 300 people. But the ecosystem that we have has 100,000 people, but they don't work for us. They work for our partners. And this is how, and a good example in the technology world, how it works. You create a whole ecosystem. And our ecosystem has enrolling agencies, operators, or, you know, we have 50,000 operators out there who are trained on this technology. But to manage this, we manage using data. So the important thing is, if you want to do large-scale projects in government, you have to have highly granular data that you build, and then you can sort of farm out the work. So the work can be farmed out. So our enrollment is done by one set of guys, the letters are delivered by the post office, so everything is sort of outsourced in this whole thing. But these 300 people are managing this whole thing with data, so they are exactly, because of very high level of granular data, they know exactly at any given point how things are going. And therefore, that's an example of how you can apply this technology to a large project. So we have enrolling agencies, we have certification, device testing, and then we have the authentication agency. So everything is built as an ecosystem which allows you to scale this up very rapidly, which is one of the reasons why we're able to do so many per day. We talked about the stations. This is a typical site of an enrollment. This is an enrollment center in Andhra Pradesh, and you can see a long line of women standing together number. This is a very, very popular thing. We have, you know, millions of people all over the place lining up, and we are always faced with the challenge of opening more and more locations because there's so much of a demand for the services that we have. And I think it's another important lesson is that the reason why this is popular is because people see a value attached to it. They see this as a gateway to service. They see this as a benefit, and therefore they see it not as some kind of a, you know, attempt to pin you down, but a way to get give you benefits. So this is an example of enrollment center in Andhra Pradesh. This is an enrollment center in Jharkhand, which is a middle Indian state. Again, you can see the long line of people waiting to enroll. This is an enrollment center in Puducherry or Pondicherry. Again, you can see the numbers of people waiting patiently to enroll into the system. Similarly, this is on the authentication side. This is somebody withdrawing their money in a village in Jharkhand. And this goes back to the direct benefit transfer I talked about, because the money goes electronically into the bank account, and there's a small device there called the micro ATM. And this person puts the finger on the device, authenticates, and gets the money. So it's like an ATM for the common man. And this is a micro payment transaction in Jharkhand. This is using the same concept for distribution of rice in Andhra Pradesh. So this person goes to the public distribution shop, puts their finger, authenticates the identity, takes the rice, and goes home. And this, again, is online verification of identity. So basically, using the same identity verification platform, we're able to distribute rice or food or money or whatever is required. This is an old age pension in Tripura. This is a live application. All these are live applications. We're doing, you know, thousands of transactions every day. So this lady is able to authenticate and get her pension, you know. Now, just to understand, in the old days, to get a pension, she had to go to a bank branch, which was many kilometers away. She had to go to a government employee, or she had to go to a postman. Now, somebody with this small handheld device can come to the village and do the distribution. And therefore, distribution becomes very simple, and it's very, very convenient for people to get access to the money. And that's really the whole value, that you are making it convenient for people to get access to public services. The other big thing is how it empowers the person at the point of service delivery. Because what happens in government services, certainly in India and maybe elsewhere, is that historically, to get a government service, you went only to one location, or you could only go to one place. And therefore, when you have only one place from which you get a government service, then the bargaining power is with the supplier, because they call the shots, because there's nobody else, nowhere else you can go, because, you know, he's the only person you can go to. Therefore, you can, you know, you can make you come some other time. You can ask for some rent or whatever. What this does is, because the ID verification is online, I can suddenly create a multiple outlet network where I, as the customer or the beneficiary, can go to anyone to get my money or anyone to get my rice. And the moment you create a choice architecture where I can go to anybody to get my service, automatically the bargaining power and convenience shifts to the user. And this is actually the most important benefit socially for the person, that now they're empowered to go to anyone to withdraw their money. And we're doing this right now in Andhra Pradesh, where there are several thousand of these machines. And a person gets the money to the bank account. Now they can go to any one of these machines in theory and withdraw the money. And therefore, that's a very important social benefit of technology, that by creating an ID on the cloud and by creating verification anywhere, suddenly you have empowered that person to go anywhere to withdraw whatever their services are. This is what I talked about as a know your customer. You know, we can use it to get a mobile connection. You can buy a train ticket and so on. So we expect over the next few years that this will be used as the basic ID or basic know your customer for all kinds of services, for voting, for bank account, for mobile connections. And this is how you're really using technology to really suddenly reach out and reach out something to a large number of people. This is the electronic thing. So this is really how the thing works on the benefit transfer. On one side, you have a list of beneficiaries. By using the Aadhaar number, you remove duplicates, which is a very big challenge in many of these programs. You send that electronically, goes into the bank account, and you go to one of these micro ATMs and withdraw the money. And this entire thing is traceable at the individual transaction level. So you can, you will have complete auditability saying exactly how much money was sent from which government program to which individual and how much did they withdraw on which day. So it's sort of a quantum leap of transparency that you get, which is very, very important for these programs. This is an example of the micro ATM I talked about. It's nothing but a small device with a mobile connection in it and with a fingerprint reader. And this is, will cost just $300 or so. And these prices will keep coming down as things become more this thing. And these can operate anywhere where the mobile network is. And therefore, it works anywhere in the country. And I'll just show you. So basically, this person can go to any outlet anywhere in the country, withdraw the money from any bank. Think of it as a massive ATM network for the common man. So this is essentially using the identity verification, debit credit using standard banking technology, and allowing people to get access. So this is an example of an application. So the very sophisticated application is being used for very, very basic issues. Now, I think a lot of people ask about privacy and security and all that. Fundamentally, this is just an ID system. This just gives you an ID and verifies your ID. So the UID database does not collect all kinds of data about you. It really collects only very basic information, your name, your address, your date of birth, your sex, and your biometrics. And it provides verification services where you go to get a particular service and you say a yes or a no. The data of your health records is with the healthcare provider. The data of your banking records is with your banking provider. So everybody keeps their part of the data. So there's no, it's not Big Brother here. It's not about massive data collection. It's just a simple ID system. And therefore, it's designed to be optimal in its privacy dimension. And similarly, from a security perspective also, a lot of work has happened to make it secure. So I think, let me just briefly end by talking about the technology, why technology can leapfrog development. As I mentioned when I began, something like this could not have been done 5 years back. So what's happened in the last 5 years? You have seen the arrival of these large internet databases which have a billion people in them. So if you can have a billion people with a Facebook account, you can have a billion people for an ID system. So scale has been made possible. Second is that the communication has become far more ubiquitous. India is a country which has something like 700-800 million mobile users. And mobile connectivity is in every nook and corner of the country. And mobile connectivity already provides for data connectivity. So in some sense, we are piggybacking on mobile connectivity because our online verification services are essentially possible only because connectivity is there. And therefore, we have ubiquitous connectivity, so you can use connectivity everywhere to provide online verification. The third thing is that this biometric technology has reached a point of maturity where we can think about creating a database of a billion people and deduplicating them and making sure that everybody gets a unique number. Fourth thing is the arrival of small devices, smartphones and tablets, which allow us to provide these services on any device, anywhere, in a village with long battery life and all that. So, and so on and so forth. So what's happening is because the technology world is moving at such a dramatic pace, it's allowing you to think of ways of solving problems that you could not solve before. And therefore, what we have done is simply take the existing, everything that we've taken is existing state of the art in different fields, but put it together for a very different purpose using very sophisticated technology for solving the problems of the most deprived. And in some sense, leapfrogging, because this ID system, since you're doing it now, you might as well do it using all this stuff, and leapfrogging in a way that was not possible before. And I believe that this approach to using technology for development can be applied in a wide variety of areas. For example, you could develop a next generation healthcare record system using this technology for, you know, for developing countries, or you could use it for massive online education or whatever. So I think the important thing is to realize that today we have reached a point where large, intractable social problems, which not all problems, but many of them can be solved using what we have. And this is nothing but one example of that use, which I hope will demonstrate what is possible elsewhere and everywhere. Thank you very much.
I see your energy and enthusiasm, not only the wisdom and savvy that went into doing what you're doing. Let me ask a few questions, and then we'll see. We'll turn to our audience for comments and questions. Could you say a little bit about, maybe it's difficult, you're a minister, in effect, in your government, but, you know, one of the challenges in development is the big gap between the right policy and implementation. And I think this is increasingly recognized in the last couple of years. One of our senior fellows, Lant Pritchett, has been writing a lot about this, and he's now actually in India.
The flailing state and all that.
The flailing state and all that. And so it's interesting because, you know, for years at the World Bank and in academia, all the discussion about what's the right policy doesn't really take you to when you get to the right policy, and if you get to it, then how do you get it done? Mm-hmm. Could you say a little bit about how you got it done?
Sure.
And what were the challenges you faced, either political or budget or anything that gives us a feel?
You want
feel.
Me to say that publicly?
Yes.
If my journalist friend's here. Well, let me...
Maybe in the context...
Let me put it
positive. Right?
Yeah.
Tremendous.
Well,
yeah. Right.
Well, I think first of all, you know, let me make one thing clear, which is that this could not have been done without unstinted, unequal, and unswerving political and government support. So you can't do these kind of things because it involves taking on a lot of challenges and incumbent interests who may not want to see this happening. So I think having that unstinted and very visible government top leadership political support is critical to anything of this type. So that let's acknowledge that, the first thing. Second thing is that I think the government also was, it happened before I came along, very wisely said we'll create a separate entity to give IDs. And this doesn't happen, by the way, in many places, because ID giving is sort of the domain of some existing ministry or something, which typically has a particular application tied to it. But this concept of an ID as an ID which can be used by all government departments was actually quite a brilliant decision that they took. So that was the second big thing. Third thing was that this was a new organization. It was a startup. I was employee number one. So, you know, and therefore when you're doing a startup, you have more leeway. You can get the right bunch of people, you can create your own culture and so on. So we were able to assemble a really talented team of people from within the government and from outside who all came with a very passionate desire to make a difference. And therefore, the culture and the level of energy, the speed at which we operate is unusual.
Brilliant. Diplomat.
And then finally, I think we... coming to the thing, our view was that there's bound to be opposition, right? Mm-hmm. So that's a given. So we said, how do we address that? One was, do it quickly. Because, you know, if you do it quickly, then it's less likely to coalesce against you. The second was, do it quietly, you know, get it done. And third was, we said that in any case, there's going to be a coalition of opponents. So is there a way to create a positive coalition of people who have a stake in its success? So one of the big things here is that there's a huge coalition of you know, organizations, governments, banks, companies, others who have a stake now in its future. So, you know, create a positive coalition that has the strength to overpower or to deal with anyone who opposes it.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was interesting how many times you referred directly or indirectly to how popular it is. So one of the members of the coalition are the citizens.
The fact that 380 million people have voted with their feet to stand in the sun and enroll is the best endorsement you can have.
So one more question that's kind of along the same lines. You know, if we take the famous example now of the commitment of the G20 to reduce fossil fuel subsidies. So in India, as you referred to the subsidies that people have gotten, which are very hard to target under the old system, now the poor who need those subsidies, when market prices are charged, have the ID in order to get they get the cash transfer, which of course is excellent because it gives them all the choices about, you know, if they use less energy, they get a certain amount of cash independent of how much.
Well, right now the way it works is that they reimburse the difference between the target subsidy price and the market price.
Only when they buy it. So could you say a little bit about how it works now that you don't have everyone with an ID? Is this being done in pilot areas, or what?
Yeah,
you'd manage the transition?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the government has launched it in phase one in 43 districts. There are about 600 odd districts in India. And recently, about 2 weeks back, they added another 78 districts. So each district you first of all make sure all the beneficiaries are enrolled into the ID system.
In the entire
Then district. You make sure that the beneficiary list in the government databases are updated with the ID so that you remove all ghosts and duplicates. Then you make sure the person has a bank account, and then you start crediting the money. So there's a whole process. So we are rolling it out district by district.
And then once that's done, then in those districts, it's no longer
the good thing here is that while there's a fair amount of housekeeping to be done before you get onto all this, because you have to give them IDs and open bank accounts and update the government database. Once you do all these things, then the continuing transactions are very, very simple, because you just have to send a electronic message and you can do all the credits. So it's the hard work is in making all these things work. So that they will do district by district.
And who are the losers in that, when that transition is made?
Well, I mean, obviously, this has the potential to make sure the right people get all the money.
Right. I mean, this is really profoundly important, you know, not just for India, but for so many countries. It's very interesting. I'll share with everyone. Christine Lagarde gave a speech at the center about a year ago now, I guess, or maybe less, before Rio +20. And in the speech, she was discussing this problem of indirectly, the politics of reducing these kinds of subsidies. She was referring to energy subsidies because she was talking about the greenhouse gas emission issue, but you could apply it to many other kinds of subsidies, which often end up giving more to the rich who are consuming more of something than is necessary or warranted politically. And she told the story of Iran, and I've never forgotten it, because what they did in Iran, I hope I get this more or less right, is they put money in people's accounts that was locked. Everyone knew that she had that resource in her checking account. And the day when they let the price rise and took away the subsidy in the marketplace, everyone got access to her account. But of course, that only works in a country where already everyone has a checking account, or can be helped to have one very quickly, and the ID.
Actually, this will accelerate that, because we estimate that across all schemes, there are going to be about 250 million people who get some kind of a benefit. So for this to work, everybody will have to have a bank account. So they don't have one. And that's where also this helps, because ID is also an instant KYC to open an account. So I can open accounts far more, you know, far quicker. So it'll accelerate and deepen the financial access to banking, and an agent in a village can open a bank account online.
Right. Yeah, there's going to be all kinds of unanticipated positive spillovers, I guess, is the next.
Yeah, you know, I think it's important to see the design of this as one, the ID is separate from the application, which I said
right.
from the beginning.
Key
it's very
point.
Important. It's very important that it's not commingled with some application. And then it's an open architecture where people can build more and more applications. And a good example in the Western context is the global positioning system, or GPS. If you see the history of GPS, it was designed by the US government as part of, you know, Star Wars and all that stuff. And the idea was to have a set of geostationary satellites by which you could exactly triangulate and, you know, hit a missile to a particular building. And it was in 2000, the Clinton administration put this in the commercial domain, and anybody could use GPS. And today we have a multi-billion dollar industry around GPS, like maps and inertial navigating system, location-based services, all kinds of things. So I think we see all the GPS did was answer the question, where am I? That's all it does. You know, where am I? And it, you know, the system tells you you're at this location, right? And then on that, you got built all these maps and this and that. Or self-driving, all the self-driving cars use GPS. So think of this as an app that's answering the question, who am I?
Exactly.
And then you can build all kinds of applications on top of it.
All right, with that, let's go and see others who have questions. Ah, the light. Please introduce yourself so we all...
I don't.
Tom Friedman. Nandan, talk about how this ID can be used to advance and improve K-12 education.
Well, I think for education, obviously, there's a lot of other stuff happening, which is classes online, courses online, you know, MOOCs and all these things that are coming on. I think the big value of this will be in, for example, when you conduct tests online remotely, how do you know that same person is taking the test, right? So you need real ID verification. So this ID system can be used, because if you're going to be testing people online, giving credits, giving degrees, you jolly well have to make sure he's the right guy. And I think it's going to help in that kind of an app.
I'm Larry Bridwell, and I saw you 4 years ago at Carnegie Council, the book Imagining India, which I've used 4 years now with my MBA students in New York City. Being in New York City, I have a lot of students from India. And in your book, you talk about how you've got the vested interests who want to preserve things, and then you've got this imagining a new India that's going to cause all kinds of changes. And of course, there's an election right now where some of these things will come about. But I don't want to put you in the spot because you're a minister of the government. But 10, 15 years from now, what is your forecast of how much will India change, or will the vested interests still maintain a lot of power?
Well, I think, you know, obviously, incumbents wouldn't like to give up power. So there's going, but I think the huge demand, which is going to come from, you know, literally a billion young people, is going to drive a huge amount of change. And many of these things that we're doing will essentially empower people with the tools to ask for the change that they want. So I'm very optimistic and positive about the future.
Or maybe I should go where there's a closer mic. Can you pass it to Stacy and then Frank, and then we'll go back to you. Okay.
I'm just,
introduce yourself.
I'm sorry, Stacy Warden, I'm with the Milken Institute. And I can imagine that these identifiers make it much easier for banks, much easier for online education, make the people that have these identifiers much more desirable consumer for these institutions. And I'm wondering, just in the short term, the next year or 2 years, when not everybody has been rolled into the system, if you foresee any kind of problems with discrimination or people not having access to banks or not having access to education or all the other kinds of benefits that they, because you just can't, simply can't handle the volume.
No, I mean, obviously, it'll take many more years till everybody gets into the system. But for people not in the system, it's not any worse than what it is today, right?
Right.
So, but for people who come into the system, you're essentially reducing transaction costs.
Except that if it becomes a requirement for a bank, right? Because
No. It's not a requirement. It will not be a requirement unless sufficient people of that category have that number. So they won't, you can open a bank account without this. There's no issue. Except that you can open a bank account faster with this. Or people who could not open bank accounts earlier can now open it because they have this. So we're always trying to make sure that there's a value to having it as opposed to, you know, making it a negative thing.
It's expanding choices in general. Let's go there and then back to Frank.
Solomon Saul. Mr. Nilekani, since you're, excuse me for saying this, not the typical politician, what would you suggest to the politicians in terms of rules and laws, since you're very astute with technology, you know, to make rules so that this system is not abused?
You're talking in particular about this system?
It can be used anywhere in the world because, I mean, if you go back in basically in history, the communist world, according to me at least, you know, they used a lot of their systems to abuse.
Yeah, no, obviously, and, you know, we are trying to, both in the architecture, the technology, the proposed law that we have for this, are all actually designed to sort of encompass its usage essentially for a development purpose. But I think there are a lot more things happening today you should be worrying about because, you know, today the level of your online world knowing what you do, I mean, if you go and do a search for a restaurant in Washington, somebody knows that you're searching for a restaurant in Washington. So, or if you post your picture on a social networking site. So I think there's a huge amount of that already. For example, you know, you now have black boxes in cars that look at your driving. And people are doing it because they're getting better insurance rates on the driving. So I think this privacy and convenience are always a trade-off. You're willing to give up something for something. Now, when you look at this particular project, I think, yes, we will have a lot of safeguard. But finally, for a few hundred million people, the upside of reducing transaction cost, reducing barrier of entry to getting what they have to get, is so much larger than the downside.
Okay, Henrietta, let's go. If you'll bear with me, Frank, because we have a board member. It's right by the mic, Henrietta.
Thank you. Henrietta Four. Could you talk about the intersection of citizenship with this ID system, guest workers in the country, students in the country?
It's an ID system for residents. So possession of this number does not confer citizenship. It's just an ID system. Because the establishment of citizenship is actually a function that typically the Home Ministry or the Interior Ministry or whatever does in a country. So we basically just say X is X. And somebody else is going to say whether X is a citizen or not. So it's just an ID system.
And that's available for subsidies payments.
No. Every department which gives a subsidy has to go through the process, due diligence of ascertaining who's eligible. Mm-hmm. So that does not go away here. All you're saying is John. The John is eligible for rice or John is eligible for some benefit is that department's business.
Frank, what about transparency?
Huh? Thank you. Frank, introduce yourself.
Oh, how did you guess, Nancy? Thank you. I'm Frank Vogel. I'm with Transparency International and the Partnership for Transparency Fund. We do many projects in India at the village and small town level and use the right to information law a lot with communities because many citizens just don't know what their rights are, what benefits they should obtain, and therefore there's tremendous corruption. You put us almost out of business, so it's a wonderful. We are delighted. But
there's lots of work for you. There's lots of work.
But we're delighted. But explain to us a bit about how you connect this to things like the right to information law so that citizens now really know what their entitlements are so that they can then come and use the system?
Well, you ought to build those apps, but let me give an example of what happens potentially when somebody is supposed to get a benefit, right? Let's say that there's a pension program which gives a old person, aged person, some 500 rupees a month. What this does is gives you complete traceability, saying that this person X was credited 500 rupees as a pension in this government department on this date, and that information is essentially, you can have it out. So the beneficiary will, it's non-repudiable in the sense that a person can say whether he got it or didn't get it, and we can verify that using these things. So it changes the whole game. Today you have no way of knowing whether somebody got the benefit, he says he didn't get it, somebody says he got it, somebody's taking. So all that goes away, it's all just transparent on the cloud, it's on the internet. So it creates a level of granular transparency that is, way above anything you have. Obviously, it doesn't solve the problem of what is he eligible for. That you have built other systems for that. But in the business of benefits reaching from the sender to the receiver, that entire chain is now visible.
This part about it takes away the monopoly of the former public or private provider is really key. Ed.
Ed Scott. It's really quite remarkable. I mean, you make the point that 5 years ago you couldn't have done this. And yet, I don't know how long ago you started. I don't remember the date. But in the time since you've started, which is less than 5 years, you have registered a number of people in excess of the entire population of the United States. And that's just stunning. I mean, that kind of momentum, in any marketing theory, you see it with a Google, you see it with a Facebook, where there's clearly a hole in the market, and once it's filled, people just rush into it. I wonder what you think about the possibility of a global system, and whether or not you think by the year 2050 there could be a global system. You can easily imagine all the different kinds of things that you could do with a global system, from airline tickets to getting money when you travel overseas, to substituting for passports, to track criminals. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. And frankly, I think it would be a real influence in knocking down the nation state, which I think needs knocking down. And so my question to you is, do you think there's any potential for having a global system by the year 2050?
So before you answer that question, is this the thin edge of the wedge of the end of sovereignty?
I'm just being plumbing.
In a globally interdependent and interconnected world, are you finally going to lead us into the 21st century?
I don't have any such pretensions. But there's nothing technologically limiting to have the whole population of the world on the system.
But what do you think the prospects are? By 2050, that's a long time from now.
I have no idea.
It's too smart to answer. Arvind, Susan. We'll stay at the front and then we'll go. I saw some.
Nandan, I had a question.
Introduce yourself, Arvind.
I'm Arvind Subramanian with the center. You spoke a lot about, the potential services that citizens could get from this.
Residents.
But, in India, this scheme is frankly being described as a game changer, in many ways. Now, could you speak to one aspect, because there is a view that, you're going to break down vested interests, the corruption, therefore you're going to get this. But one of the big ways in which might be a game changer is actually by strengthening the state and creating a more effective state. On the one hand, you empower citizens so that they get more rights and they can put pressure on the state. And on the other hand, by making delivery efficient, the legitimacy of the state goes up. So could you speak, do you kind of think that this is finally about more efficient state formation?
Yeah, because I think if you're able to deliver See, this essentially gives you the ability for you to deliver any benefit to any individual. So if the government, for example, has a million pensioners, people getting pension, you can go individually into their bank accounts, or if take credit. You can now build a credit history on top of this. You can use the ID and build a credit history, and therefore you can now start giving credit more efficiently to lots of people who don't have access to credit. Or you can build an electronic health record system which sits on the cloud, and your health record is portable. You can take it with you wherever you go. So it gives all kinds of, but remember that technology and technology diffusion are two different things, right? I mean, it takes many, many years before a technology reaches maturity in use. So what we have created and what we hope by next year is to have at least 500 million people on the system and have at least a couple of major applications like direct benefit transfer on it. And then as people understand its capability, then more and more people will build new apps. And so over time, the richness of applications will develop. But that's it's a multi-year process. But we're laying but from day one, we're building it foundationally. In some sense, you know, if you look at the big things in the US, the internet, what the internet is today is not what it was designed. But over time, because it was designed so well, it became a platform for all kinds of innovation. GPS became a platform for all kinds of innovation. So here is a conscious attempt to build a platform for innovation. And to that extent, in my view, this is how the public-private thing can play, you know, because these kind of infrastructural things, only governments can do. You know, this can't be done by private companies. But if you can create the platform and make it open and allow innovation to happen, then you can marry the innovation of people and enterprise with the platform capacity of the state.
It's a real network thing. Susan, I have Susan, Michelle, Howard, a lot of questions. Just a few minutes. It's great to keep your questions short, which people have done, and it's really great to have very good answers, crisp and clear and short as well. We'll get more questions. Susan.
I'm Susan Levine. I'm on the board of CGD, and I'm already a beneficiary of biometrics with using my Clear card to jump the lines at airports. But I'm curious if you could talk a little bit about the cost of implementing this and how the cost is being funded, what it is.
It's entirely funded by the central government, the federal government, from their budget. It costs about $2 to $3 per person. It costs about a dollar to enroll the person and about $1 or $2 for the processing and the letter that we sent. So our estimate is that for the entire population, it will be $3.6 billion. And the annual expenditure on subsidies and entitlements is $60 billion. So even if you get some level of productivity there, it pays for itself.
Right. I had like this. Michelle, and then Howard.
There's a study, by the way, by NIPFP, which is an independent study on what is the return on this investment of the project.
Hi, my name is Michelle DeNevers. I'm at the Center for Global Development. So my question, it may sound trivial, but it's not. So you've enrolled 380 million people. You have about 800 million to go. And you're enrolling at 1 million a day. How do you decide who is the next million? How do you create your
queue? No, it's anytime, anywhere enrollment. So we have enrollment, about 25 to 30,000 enrollment stations in lots of states. So people walk up and enroll. We also have online, you can book a slot and then come and enroll. So it's an on-demand model. Because this again is important that the backend takes care of the deduplication. So you can enroll anywhere. If you enroll twice, we'll catch one of them. So, you know,
right.
That's fine.
Howard.
So it's a anytime, anywhere kind of, walk-in kind of.
Thanks. Hi, Howard Schneider with the Washington Post. So I'm wondering what evidence you've got so far as a development prospectus, development proposition of knock-on private investment as a result of this, of banks expanding services or whatever?
It's a little premature for that because the first set of applications which are related to direct benefit transfer are just getting rolled out. But actually, we have already had an impact on the technology ecosystem because what we have created is a model where different technology companies can compete in providing the equipment. So we have created a huge opportunity for fingerprint scanners, iris readers. So we're really pushing the envelope on this because before this, essentially, these were all closed loop systems where, you know, a project bought it from one particular supplier. We opened it up and made a multi-vendor situation. So I think just the impact on the vendor ecosystem has already happened. Like our biometric deduplication has three different companies at the back who compete in some sense.
I'm going to ask a quick question and then go to Smita for our last one. I apologize to those of you who didn't have a chance, but we will have a reception afterwards, so you can try to come up and accost Nandan. My quick question is, should the World Bank and the Asian Development Bank and Nancy Lee's Multilateral Investment Fund at the Inter-American Development Bank, are they interested? Are they following what you're doing? Should they be trying to foment this approach in low-income countries that are just behind India or maybe too far behind India, I don't know, in the capacity
to... Yeah, I think that, I mean, it's up to them to do that. But I think this idea is a basic challenge, which I didn't realize myself till I took this up, that if your underlying system of giving identity to people is not functioning as the way it should, then you're going to have a large number of your residents and citizens who don't have an ID. And then that ultimately creates an identity divide, you know, separates the people, the have from the have-nots. And therefore, I think this is a very critical thing for many countries. And I think it's important to, we believe that this approach is the right approach where you give a number, it's online, where you give it to all residents and then decide later about, you know, who's a citizen and all that, and build applications on top. So I think the conceptually, the architecture we have followed, we believe is replicable elsewhere. But finally, it's for those governments and the bank and all that to make it happen.
Right, right. Smita, please introduce yourself.
Smita Singh, I'm on the board of the center. Thank you for
also,
very-
Also, let me say, maybe this is a, Smita is on the President Obama's Global Development Council, so maybe something about this is a message you'll bring to that group, which is chaired by our friend Mohammed El Arian, so we'll get him the message. Anyway.
Thank you for the shout out, Nancy. Thank you for a very interesting and thought-provoking talk. So I have two questions. One is more of a demographic question. Who is signing up? Do you know? Is it primarily from the middle classes, people online connected already, or from lower income? And then my second question, to some extent, the earlier speaker touched upon it, but this would seem to be an absolute treasure trove for private sector companies. I mean, and so my question is, you talk about it being an open platform, and meaning that anybody, foreign companies, domestic, can begin to use the ID system incorporated into their provision of services, or will there be some kind of, and I'm thinking of, you know, Apple, the app process, where Apple essentially controls what apps can be developed or put on the smartphone?
Yeah, well, it's, I mean, it's open in the sense that any entity can build an app, but we have a thing called an authorized user agency, so they have to enter into an agreement with us. To that extent, it is controlled in, but, you know, it's we welcome many applications to come, but ultimately it's a trusted environment. It's an environment of known actors. And I think, see, again, the data that is collected here is very rudimentary. It's, you know, it's your name, address, date of birth, and sex. It's stuff which is on your passport or your driver's license. So there's no particular value for the information. And the data about a person in the context of an application is in their application. So the way it works is that you go to the bank and you withdraw 1,000 rupees. And the bank wants to verify your ID, all it does is send an ID request to us and we reply saying, yes, it is the same person. So the ID system doesn't know what happened in the bank. It doesn't know what money you withdrew. So this kind of a federated architecture where we don't know what the bank is doing, and the bank is just using ID, is actually making sure that you don't create too much of data concentration with one actor. So it's really an ID. It's only an ID verification system. It's only you go somewhere and say I'm X, and we say yeah, it is indeed X. I confirm it to you. Oh, we see. We don't check incomes and all that because so. But it's the age distribution and the sex distribution is on our website. It's we have we plot all that. But it's a proxy for the population. It's got urban. It's got rural. It's got rich. It's got poor. But it's not necessarily meant only for the tech savvy people because they don't know how to, and they won't know how to go and book a slot online. That's more for the urban types. So we have a very large, but the big demand is actually from people who don't have an ID or people who are migrants. So definitely it is dealing with a class of people who are the most disadvantaged.
Yeah, the answer to Smita's first question was a little bit, it's about treating people, well, you said all residents, but as citizens, not as potential consumers, which is an interesting and important piece of maybe what's working so well.
Sure.
Nandan, thank you so much. I hope you'll come back when you're not a minister anymore, and we can ask you questions about India and about tech in general,
sure.
And about the future of the world, indeed, which
sure,
Ed
world.
Referred to. Thank you so much for a vital talk. Thank you.